Welcome. Welcome to our first collective annual banquet hosted by the Iowa City Area Business Partnership, Think Iowa City, and Iowa City Area Development Group. I'm Tom Banta. I'm the interim president of Iowa City Area Development Group. On behalf of all three teams and board members, welcome. It's good to see so many familiar faces and a number of new ones. So enjoy the evening.
Good evening. My name is Josh Schamberger, and I have the privilege of serving as the president of Think Iowa City and the Iowa City Area Sports Commission. This evening marks the first time our three organizations have come together to celebrate our achievements through a joint annual banquet. We are proud of our continued efforts to collaborate and align our work under a more unified economic and community development vision. Thank you for joining us this evening.
Hello, everyone. I'm Kim Casco, President and CEO of the Iowa City Area Business Partnership, and I'm so excited to be sharing the stage tonight with these two guys who have both challenged me with their persuader-controller personalities and have also been big supporters with their big, kind, generous hearts. So thank you to my partners in crime here. We are gonna have some fun tonight. Let me tell you, we're gonna be sharing our accomplishments and celebrating our accomplishments from 2022. We're gonna share our big goals for 2023. We're gonna have President Wilson back up on the stage with us, and we're super excited for our keynote, Rebecca Ryan, who helped guide us, you know, over the past year in developing the all-in vision for our community, and she's just gonna bring the house down with her energy and inspiration and future looking forward. So, yes, everyone sit back, enjoy the night. Before we dive in, we've got some folks we need to thank. I want to acknowledge all of our annual banquet sponsors. This party would not be possible if it weren't for their generous support. And I want to first start with our lead sponsor, Procter & Gamble, who are sitting right over here, table 8. Yes. So I'm gonna do my best podcast-like commercial here for a moment. Procter & Gamble provides branded products and services of superior quality and value, which serve nearly 5 billion people all over the world, and all 500 of you in this room. And they continue to grow right here in Iowa City. P&G, thank you for continuing to generously sponsor this event. Thank you also to our four supporting sponsors: Newman Munson Architects, Imon Communications, the University of Iowa, and the Gazette. We are incredibly grateful for your support. And last but not least, thank you to our many table sponsors for your support and continued investment in our work.
This evening, we wanted to just not talk about, but show you a few of the more impactful moments and projects from 2022. So our team worked to summarize this through a short video. Many of you were heavily involved in these projects and events, so expect to see a few familiar faces. The video will also touch on a few things we are especially looking forward to in the coming year. But more on that as tonight's program develops. For now, please sit back and enjoy a few of the collective successes from 2022.
First one I'll start with is our Small Business Scholarship. And this is a program that really essentially provides a scholarship for membership to the Business Partnership, a free membership in year one. And if certain kind of program requirements are met, they get a half-price membership the second year. And it's really, you know, an effort to be more inclusive, to engage those who aren't typically members of our organization and really bring them in and help get them connected to resources. Year one of the program, we've got 15 enrolled so far, and thanks to Hills Bank sponsoring the program, we're gonna be able to take 15 more. A second highlight from the year, I would say
is a couple of the new programs that we were able to launch this year, one of those being our executive leadership program, ELP. It's really for C-suite leaders and helping them to engage in the challenges that they need to these days. And we're partnering with the Tippy College of Business on that. They're fantastic partners. And so we had the first cohort this past year. We graduated 19 folks from them. We've got 22 signed up for the next cohort. Kind of a side effect is just the way it's connecting leaders across the community. The third big highlight, I would say, is this is a big one, is workforce. We heard a lot from our businesses, you know, over the past couple of years, what's the greatest challenge workforce? An example of some of the short-term things that we did is, you know, develop a workforce resources guide for businesses to use to help, you know, with those challenges within their organizations. And then in terms of the long-term approach, one of the big things we've been working on for a long time, even pre-pandemic times, is the childcare. You know, figuring out how to increase the amount of, you know, the quantity, the quality, and the affordability of childcare.
So when I think about 2022, it's really hard to pick a few of the highlights, but some that jump out to me are Builders and Backers. That program and the amount of response that we've had at the community level, the opportunity that it's created for a number of folks that traditionally potentially had not connected to these resources, and what it's done as another addition to the entrepreneurial ecosystem is tremendous. And a lot of that credit goes to Liz and a number of the partners that have been involved to make that happen. Another thing that I'm particularly excited about from 22 that has already had an immediate impact has been the hiring of Sarah Thompson to focus on our rural economic development. She has immediately hit the ground running. She brings a wealth of knowledge and expertise and a tremendous energy to this work, and she's already invigorated communities like Lone Tree and Swisher and a lot more to come. Another element of our work that's exciting and we've made big strides in 22 was the Iowa EdTech Collaborative. And really it's a vision to reimagine the education technology sector and create a space that attracts and develops and grows the next generation of solutions providers for education and education technology. And so Mark Butland and a number of others have been hard at it, trying to develop and refine different initiatives, from Classroom of the Future as a way to test and pilot and introduce students to new technologies, to the Iowa Quality Seal of Approval, which creates a validation or an efficacy pathway for these emerging technologies. We've got a legacy in this space, one that we want to continue to build upon and grow for years to come.
As far as highlights for 2022 go, certainly the hosting of the recent UWW Freestyle and Women's Wrestling World Cup is top of mind. Our community welcomed 19 nations for the better part of 2 weeks. And whether you are from Kyrgyzstan, China, Iran, Georgia, Azerbaijan, or even Ukraine, you walked away with an unforgettably positive impression of Iowa, and you felt the promise behind the WrestleTown USA brand.
The fact that going to World Cup and seeing all of these wonderful nations come to represent themselves and participate in the sport they love, I became hooked. I was absolutely cheering and yelling and screaming. It was amazing to see the athleticism at play. I just really think that when you hear the term all roads lead to Iowa, never more was it more apparent to me what that means until I went to the World Cup.
Other big time highlights for me include the inaugural hosting of the Girls State Wrestling and Volleyball Tournaments, the Boys State Baseball Tournament, Girls State Tennis, and so on and so on. And also the continued development of the Bike Iowa City brand and the great work by Liz Hubing, the Core 4 event, RagBri's 9th return to Johnson County is this year, the continued expansion of our single track and flow tracks by Coralville, Iowa City, are all highlights thanks to an incredible local cycling community.
Our merger between the Business Partnership and the Iowa City Area Development Group, you know, it's something that has been talked about on and off, you know, for a long time, and this just feels like the right moment for it. Our organizations have been through a lot collectively since the pandemic hit in 2020. Our work is just overlapping more and more, and so I couldn't be more excited. You know, we're already have been living together since 2019, so Now we're engaged, and you'll all be invited to the wedding.
And now it just seems like we're finally getting that momentum, and I know the team, both at ICAD and at the business partnership, have put so much time and effort into this. Couldn't be more proud of the people involved, really trying to join forces, figure out where there's some overlap, where both organizations were working on certain projects, that now we can be more aligned and push things a little bit further, a little bit faster. And then also just coming up with new ideas and new initiatives. You know, this is a time of change where there's going to be some new ideas, maybe some new services or things like that yet to be discussed that we can look into and just provide better support for our local businesses and just make Iowa City area a really great place to live, work, and thrive.
So as I think about 2023, the big looming opportunity ahead really is what lies ahead for the co-creation, the collaboration, the alignment of Iowa City Area Development and the Iowa City Area Business Partnership. And that's something I'm the most excited about. And it's our opportunity as we reimagine and redesign our organizations. How do we do it in a way that meets the work where it's at, uses a 2030 lens to help fuel what's going forward, and layer that over the voice of our customer and constituents in the room today, as well as those that aren't here today, and build an organization and a network of organizations ready to meet the needs of today and our future?
What excites me most about the merger is the opportunity for the staffs to work together and to actually do more. They truly are better together. You look at over the last 2 years, what they've been doing and how they've come together through the pandemic and offered some additional support to businesses as needed. And they've really stood out as being a strong group working together. Just officially doing that, I think brings a lot of opportunity to the communities and the businesses that we support.
Probably the most meaningful highlight was the transition from Project Better Together to Better Together 2030. And the appointment of Katie Gerlach. It's the most meaningful because it's the most important. That is our organization and our peers and all of you supporting, participating, and investing into this plan for our shared future. I'm so pleased and happy to just be one cog in that larger wheel as we approach and plan for 2030.
I'm really, really excited to now execute on that vision and have it not just sit on a shelf. And there's a lot of work underway already across the five pillars, a lot of great projects and a lot of them that connect with each other. And again, we need all hands on deck. We need everybody engaged. So I'm really excited to grow that engagement.
One of the things that I feel is most exciting about the Better Together 2030 is really it serves as an anchor to bring our entire community together. And I believe that there is something in here for everyone. I think that there's an opportunity, depending on your interests, your passion, your desires, to plug into this work within one of the five pillars, if not more. And really the opportunity I see is bringing us together and getting us all rowing and moving in the right direction. And I look forward to what opportunities lie within this and the ability to engage the broadest parts of our community, from our business community, to the residents, to our municipalities, and everything in between.
All of the partnerships that we're looking forward to strengthening and continuing to build on those relationships that we already have so that we can, work together to see this community continue to grow in economic strength, but also in diversity and also in just fun. I mean, there are just so many things that we are planning together to be able to help this community grow and thrive as a major part of Iowa.
Thank you to my partners at the Business Partnership and ICAD. All three of our organizations have tremendous momentum, both individually and in our collective efforts. And we owe much of this to our dedicated and hardworking staff. I'd like to take a moment to acknowledge all of our team members. You begin each day with an incredible commitment and love for our community. You offer tremendous insight, professionalism, and creativity that inspires all of our collective organizations. You make all of us look good. Even Tom, he shaved today. And we truly appreciate all of your efforts to build our community. I'd like to ask each member of Think Iowa City, the Sports Commission, the Business Partnership, and ICAD to stand and be recognized. Thank you for your hard work.
We also want to recognize and thank our board of directors. The last few years have brought a lot of change, but our community is resilient and we are making progress more than ever due to your dedication and commitment to working together. You have made bold decisions that will lead us confidently into the future. We are extremely grateful for the wisdom and guidance and countless hours you have generously provided, and for free. Our fellow board members of Think Iowa City, the Iowa City Area Business Partnership, and ICAD, will you please stand and join me in thanking our boards for their investment in our organizations and our community. Please stand.
All that we accomplished in 2022 would not get done without all of us. We also want to thank our peer economic development partners. Will the staff and board members from the following organizations please stand and stay standing? The Iowa City Downtown District and the newly formed South District SMID, south of 6th. As well as all of the ICR regional partners from the 7-county region and our friends from the north from the Cedar Rapids Metro Economic Alliance. It's a privilege to work alongside you. Together, we have tackled enormous challenges and have seen outstanding progress. Through highs and lows, we truly value your commitment to working together and growing our region. Please join me in thanking this group of community-focused people for their partnership and good work.
We also want to acknowledge and thank our elected and city officials and strong partners within UI leadership. We are so appreciative of the working relationships that each of us have with you. I've served in this role for more than 2 decades now, and I've never felt as though we really are more together. That begins with all of you and the leadership that you provide us and this community. If you're a federal, state, or local elected official, if you're a school board member or a member of University of Iowa leadership, which I know there are many at this table, please stand and be recognized. Thank you for being here and your continued stewardship. Rod, that means your table.
And finally, we want to acknowledge and thank all of you, our members, ambassadors, investors, volunteers, champions, supporters. Now, I won't make you all stand, but I do want you to know that we truly value your partnership and support. Together, we are building a wonderful community that we are really proud to be a part of. Please give yourselves a pat on the back and a round of applause.
The video we just enjoyed only scratches the surface of our work. We encourage you to view each of our annual reports. You can find the QR code with a link to these reports on the front of your program. These reports will give you a full overview of our work from 2022. As you heard in the video, we at ICAD and the Business Partnership are excited to explore what a new joint entity could look like. Our boards have approved a resolution to merge ICAD and the Business Partnership. And although we have not merged yet, the important part of that is keep paying both invoices. We are beginning the design process for this new entity, and we want your insight and input. To that end, we are inviting each of you to participate in the customer discovery process to ensure we understand your needs and the challenges that lie ahead. This information will serve as the foundation in which we build a joint entity to serve our business community today and for years to come. To participate in this process, please text the word INFORM to 33777. I'll give you a second to do that. INFORM to 33777. And from here, we'll send you an invitation and a link to give us a little bit more detail, and we'll look to plug you into the process going forward. We're incredibly grateful for your involvement and your continued investment in ICAD and the Business Partnership. We value your perspectives and insight as the structure of our organizations evolve.
Yes, we're excited for all the possibilities that lie ahead for this merged entity. So like Tom said, please help us design it. So we can brag about our collaborative work all night, but enough from us. It's now my privilege to introduce Dr. Barbara J. Wilson. Barb, as she likes for us to call her, began her term as the 22nd president of the University of Iowa in 2021. During her first week on the job, we asked her to be tri-chair of the Better Together 2030 initiative, and she readily accepted. Actually, I think we asked her like 3 months before she started the job, because this picture is in the Think Iowa City vehicle at her house in Illinois before she ever came here. So since then, all of us have been heavily involved in the work of Better Together 2030, as you just saw in the video. I can't tell you how grateful we are to have President Wilson's engagement, insights, leadership, here in our community supporting the All-In Vision Plan. Please welcome to the stage President Barb Wilson.
Not know that kind of music was going to be playing. I can tell that we're having fun now. So I looked at that photo, which truly was taken in Illinois, and all my neighbors back there saw this big Iowa car in my driveway. And, you know, it was the first of what I would quickly realize was tremendous partnerships between the university and Iowa City and the communities around us. And as I look at that picture, I think I look a little younger back then. And that was only a year and a half ago, so what does that mean? No, seriously, I'm not going to talk about women's basketball up here, but maybe we could just give a round of applause to our women's basketball team. Wow. And I'm not going to talk about men's basketball, which is also really going crazy right now, yeah? And finally, what about wrestling? Oh, my goodness. All right, I just had to get that out of my system. That's not the reason I'm up here. The reason I'm up here is to introduce our keynote, but before I do that, I just want to add my thanks to this community. I can tell you that every single day I meet with students and faculty and staff at the University of Iowa, and I often say, why are you here? Why are you at the university? And inevitably, they tell me that Iowa City was part of what attracted them to this great community and to this great university. And so I want to say thank you to you for that, because you're all part of making this a welcoming, vibrant community for people from all over this country. I don't know if you know this, but 45% of our undergraduates are coming to us from out of state. What a tremendous opportunity for us to be ambassadors and to convince some of them to stay here and sink roots into Iowa and into Iowa City. So thank you all for all the work you do here. When I first arrived, I was quickly asked to become part of this great venture called Better Together 2030. And I remember in one of the earlier meetings I had with the leadership team, I said something like, you know, we need you, you need us, and the stronger we collaborate, the more we'll attract and keep talent. And I said, we are all in about the University of Iowa. And then all of a sudden, that became part of the tagline for this 2030 project. So I'm really honored that my voice has been part of this and that I've been able to be a real partner to the leaders here. And little did I know it would become part of the name for the vision. We remain all in. We want to continue to recruit the best and the brightest here. And I can tell you, this year's undergraduate class was 13% higher, bigger than the year before. So that's amazing in this day and age. In the wake of COVID and with all the competition out there, for us to bring in a class of new students that's 13% higher is partly because of all of what you're doing. So thank you. And we're going to continue to attract great faculty and staff as well. Working through this process, I got the really great opportunity to work with my tri-chairs. Have you ever heard that term before? I hadn't until I got involved in this. What's a tri-chair? Anyway, it's a new term on my CV now. But I want to call out Kate Moreland and Angie Jordan, who are both here. Will you two stand up? Because you deserve a huge round of applause for everything that you did during this process. Yeah. Not only did we try chair, but we also developed a friendship, and I'm really grateful to both of you for that, so thank you. I'm delighted to introduce our keynote speaker. That's really the main reason I'm up here, not to brag about the University of Iowa, but I couldn't help myself. But I'm really excited to introduce our keynote this evening, and I can tell you that actually in all of our meetings, every time I worked with her, I was on Zoom and she was on Zoom. So the first thing I said to her tonight is, "You're a lot taller than I thought you were." And she said, "You are too." And I thought, nice going, Rebecca, but no, I'm not taller. I'm shorter than you thought I was. But I'm really excited about introducing her tonight. And, you know, Rebecca Ryan is an incredible leader. She's a noted top 50 professional futurist. So she's going to tell us a little bit more about what that means. She's an economist, and she's a best-selling author and entrepreneur. She's the founder of Next Generation Consulting, and she partners with government leaders across the country. She's looking always to the future and helping communities like ours figure out where do we want to be in the next 10, 20, 30 years. And she pushed us during that process, and I think it was really good for us to be challenged by her. Let me tell you a little bit about her Iowa roots, because I think that's what everybody really will be excited about. Rebecca is a graduate of Drake University, and she has a certificate in strategic foresight from the University of Houston. She is the resident futurist at the Alliance for Innovation, and she's on the executive committee of the Global Association of Professional Futurists. But here's the part that I know you'll love. Her first four jobs were in the state of Iowa. The Iowa Department of Education, the Iowa Department of Economic Development, the Iowa Association of Business and Industry, and Keep Iowa Beautiful. In fact, she started Next Generation Consulting in Iowa. And she named, this is the best part, she named Iowa City as the best place to live for the next generation in Iowa on her Hot Jobs, Cool Communities list in 2001. So thank you for that. That's pretty amazing. So I think you can tell Iowa means a lot to Rebecca, and she has shined through this process in helping us figure out where do we want to be in 2030. So it's my great honor and privilege to ask Rebecca to come to the stage. Please give her a warm Iowa welcome. Thank you, Rebecca.
Can we just take a beat? I just want to take a quick beat. This community is amazing. This community is amazing. I think about what President Wilson has brought since she's been here. I mean, I live in Madison. I would kill for the president of our university to stand up here for 5 minutes and just, you know, gloat, right? To have a cheerleader at this level is amazing. Here's what else is amazing. You've got two organizations about to merge. That doesn't happen in most communities. In most communities, there's just a series of breaking off and breaking off and breaking off. And what are you doing? You are coming together. We have an empty chair at our table. It wasn't intentional, but I often think about if we had a 15-year-old in 2030, you know, a few years from now, if we could imagine that 15-year-old in 2030 eavesdropping on our conversation. I'm getting a little bit of feedback on my mic. Tell me, should I just go to the... You can, she put it down. She's got it. Katie. She's keeping it real up here. But to think about if we had a child of tomorrow sitting in on this conversation tonight, we would have so much to be proud about. You know, the community, when people want to be a part of something that's becoming, and this is a community that continues to become, and you are going to be able to leapfrog the competition now, and already are with an increase of 13% in your freshman class, because you have, over the course of the last generation, been investing in things that are timeless, investing in things that all people value, right? A sense of belonging, a sense of place, and a sense of place that isn't skyscraper and enormous, but a sense of place that is at a human scale. Even coming into this building tonight, it was remarkable, like the human scale, the walkability of this. So I'm not a betting person, but I will put long money on this community because of how you are coming together. You are investing in the kinds of things that make people want to be here, the kind of place that people want to call home. So I want to talk a little bit tonight about the business of community and the community of business. Here's my cell phone number. I'm going to only show this one other time. This is really my cell phone number. If Richard Branson can give his cell phone number to 23,000 employees, I can give my cell phone number to 500 JOCO residents. Like, no problem. I got that. But I am going to take some questions a little bit later. But before that, I want to ground this in something that is truly rare. How many of you, raise your hand if you're like, you know what, in my day job, the one you get paid for, right, in my day job, I am in charge of strategy. I have got to think about strategy. Nice and high, I've got some lights in my eyes here. Okay, that looks like maybe about 40%, 43%. Yeah, but I'm an economist. We put this survey out into the field and asked our respondents, are you responsible for strategy? 95% said yes. And then we said, how do you spend your time? And it was like, on email. I mean, how do you spend your time, Rebecca? Right? Then, just drop it on the floor. Okay. I was raised by German Lutherans. There's no way I'm dropping that on the floor. I will tuck that away in a safe spot. Then we asked, all right, so 95% of them, it's their job to do strategy. And then we asked, the second question, the second part of the question, right? How many minutes per month do you spend working on the future? And we medianed that all out, and most people spend between a minute and a half and 4.5 minutes a day thinking about the future, despite the fact that 95% of these same people said it's their job. So tonight we're gonna break the average. We're gonna spend about 20 minutes talking about the future. Whoa! But this is as a backstop to all the 2030 work that so many of you spent hours and hours and hours doing together on behalf of future residents you may never meet. You're building something special here. All right, let's get into it. One of the things that I do as a futurist is I watch for weak signals. What's a weak signal? Have you ever been outside walking and like you get hit with a tiny drop of precipitation? That's familiar. What do you do when that happens? What do? You look up? Yeah, was it a bird? Right, yeah, exactly. You look up. I also put my arms out. I don't know, it's like I'm trying to be a bigger surface area. Is there more of that coming? I'm trying to determine if it's a raindrop or if it's like rain or like what are the clouds saying? A weak signal is like that first drop of rain, right? If it grows and more weak signals come around it, then it becomes almost like a rainstorm. And by the time that rain comes into a thunderstorm and people are choosing not to go to their cars or everybody's using their windshield wipers, it is like a mainstream trend. So most of us know the things that are like windshield wiper trends that everybody is thinking about. But one of the things we do as futurists is we listen for those first drops of rain, those weak signals. And some of what I want to do today is share with you some of the weak signals that we're noticing in our shop. And I want to challenge you to think about how this might apply to your organization, whether it's your day job that you get paid for, or whether it's an organization that you love, one that you volunteer for, right? So this is an example of a signal of the future. Does anybody know what this is? Does anybody know what this is? This is actually called a hunger stone. It's on the Elbe River in Europe. And it was written on hundreds of years ago, the last time the river was at this low of a level. And what it says is, if you can read this, weep. Because for prior generations, when the river got this low, there was definitely going to be a famine. So this is a hunger stone. It is a signal from prior generations of what is to come, right? This is an example of a weak signal. Here's another example. This is right out of the CIA Intelligence Analysis Handbook. When the CIA is trying to train new agents, they're trying to train them to listen for all kinds of signals. So this is one of the tests that they give CIA agents. What do you notice that's wrong? How much alcohol have you guys had tonight? Let's break it down together. I didn't get it right the first time either. Let's read it together. Yep, you got it. Paris in the spring. Now you know it. The article gets repeated inside of each of the triangles. Now, if you're a native English speaker and you recognize these idioms, right? Your eye goes right past that, despite that there's an extra word in each one. We all do this. We miss the signals that are all around us in plain sight. And I was doing a briefing for Centers for Homeland Defense and Security about signals and sense making, and the head of the education center, I had four quizzes like this, he didn't get any of them. And I was like, I'm sure you have other superpowers, sir. So signals of the future are happening all around us, and they're often on the margins, and they may be things that make us feel one of these things, right? But you know what's interesting is the human condition, as especially as we get older, as we think we've seen it all, right? We ignore things that make us feel one of these things. We're like, shrug, right? What futurists do is we pay attention, and we're like, you know, it's kind of like in the electric company. Are any of you old enough to remember that? They had the 9 box, and 8 kids were jumping rope, and one was bouncing a ball. Which of these kids is not like the other one? I'm really dating myself here. Thin ice, thin ice. But what futurists do is we look for the kid that doesn't fit everybody else, like everybody else, and we look for what might be behind that. So here are some signals. From my signals panel, I meet with a team of futurists once a week for an hour. We all bring signals around the future of communities, the future of local government, and then I turn that into a newsletter from time to time. So a couple weeks ago, Scottsdale, Arizona cuts off water to a suburb. Now, you might think, what does this have to do with Iowa? Well, a couple of things. One, the language that we are now using to talk about the changing climate is having to be updated. Here's an example. The word drought assumes that you will return to a moisture level that is not drought. But when your state has been in a drought for 25 years with no sign of coming back, we might need a different word than drought to describe it. So the language is changing. And then what else is happening? Well, this is happening, right? One way out migration from California drained U-Hauls towards the end of the pandemic. And what does that mean? Well, here's what that means. You guys went from the bottom half of one way in migrations to the top half of one way in migrations over the last 2 years, right? Why are people choosing this community, right? Why are people choosing to move one way here? It's because of this huge leapfrogging. There are a lot of communities that have not invested in quality of life amenities, have not invested in affordable housing, have not invested in making communities places where everyone feels like they can belong. And the pandemic, this existential crisis that we have faced, kind of made all of us look around and say, really? Is this where I want to be? So we stand to win from out-migration, from some of the climate things that are happening in the Mountain West. Quits rate. I remember in April of 2021 when 3.9 million people just walked out of their job voluntarily and the media went crazy. Quits rate, oh my God, the next month it was higher. The next month it was about in the same range. And on this went for over 14 months of record levels of quits, right? We still don't have all those folks back in the workforce, but you know what we have? Record numbers of new businesses starting up, right? This, to me, is a long-term signal of oxygenation in our economies. We want people to quit and start new businesses. I mean, if you're an employer, you're like, no, Rebecca, please don't. And you're like giving the dirty eyeball to everybody at your table right now, like, don't you dare try to quit. But the truth is, longer term, oxygenation is good for the economy. Competition is good for the economy. But it all stems from this. You know, COVID gave us an opportunity to truly confront our morality at one time. You know, we sort of all had this look at the billboard that says you will die at the same time, and that changes people. It's changed some of you. Some of you who aren't willing to do the work you once did for the price you once took. Some of you who aren't willing to drive into an office. Some of you who are like, I want more flexibility. You know? So we're seeing all kinds of innovation. The workplace today is like a petri dish of innovation, right? What will work, what won't work. But it all is stemming from the fact that we went through an existential crisis at the same time. Now, what has happened is this. And this has happened after all of the major world wars that the United States has been in. It's happened after the Great Depression that we've gone through, is that workers are saying, we've proven that we're reliable, that we're trustworthy, right? And now we're gonna ask for more for ourselves. So what's so interesting is just inside of 5 years, like the fight for 15, right? The fight for $15 an hour, the markets in many ways are taking care of this. I'm living in Brevard, North Carolina for a couple of months near my wife's family. And I'm at a co-working space that's in a brewery, kind of awesome. I'm in a co-working space, and next to the coat rack is a bulletin board. And on the bulletin board is an advertisement for Waffle House in Brevard, North Carolina, population 7,500. Managers at Waffle House are promised 4 day weeks, $85,000. Like, what is in those waffles? Like, I mean, that's amazing. But the bottom line in all of this is naturally our wages for labor are going up because labor is putting their, you know, feet firmly on the ground and saying, I want a different deal. You know, my time, my energy is worth more. So, and I think we'll continue to see this. We'll continue to see this. One other thing that I want to mention is this notion of, you know, our local independent papers. There are half as many people working in journalism today as there were 10 years ago. 50% fewer people are working in journalism today than 10 years ago. And some of you might think that's no big deal, but here's why it matters. We know that in communities like yours, where there's an active local newspaper, people know they're being watched, so they're less likely to be shady. You know, there's less likely to be corruption, there's less likely to be embezzlement, you're just more likely to have better operating systems when you've got the news on the beat. However, what's happening for many of us is we've transferred our information diet to other platforms that aren't run by local media. And I don't want to come down hard on these social media companies, but I do want to report a fact. And that is, and for the engineers in the crowd, right? Algorithms are programmed for an end, right? It's a math equation, right? And we're trying to solve for X. And the algorithms that are driving much of your and my attention when we're on social media sites, right, is programmed towards what? What does it want? How does the algorithm experience success? How much time you're on the, yep, time. It's usually time, right? And we now know from research that the most successful way for the algorithm to win, for it to get more and more and more of your time, is to radicalize you. UC Stanford professor of AI, I met him several years ago. He won one of the most significant futures awards from the Association of Professional Futurists. He's committed his life to the use of, to studying AI. And this was buried in a lecture that he gave in England a year and a half ago about the algorithm's programming and therefore, you know, how it solves for itself. So we are in a battle for our attention, and energy flows where attention goes. So one of the things I implore of you today is the state of New Jersey, for example, just passed information literacy for all students in New Jersey, right? So that people really know the source of the information, if it's credible information, if it's factual information. Europe is so far ahead of us, and you guys, this is one of those things where I just put my head in my hands about our country. You know, that we are not doing more to help people be smarter about the kinds of information and the kinds of, you know, the kinds of things that we're putting our energy towards. So this is, I think this is kind of a moral concern around how newspapers are dying, independent journalism, fewer people are working in independent journalism, and how the algorithms are winning. And here is the final stat, the final signal I'll leave you with for tonight. 1 in 7 American men report having no friends. Right? And so what we will know from this, a prediction we can make, is deaths of loneliness will occur. You know, loneliness is more lethal than obesity. It's more lethal than heart disease, right? So we're gonna have some long-range effects here from this. But we don't study signals of the future. We don't pay attention to signals of the future to hunker and bunker. We do this so that we face the future full on, squarely. What's happening? So that we can figure out how we're gonna handle it and work on it together. So let me turn it over to you. What signals of the future are you noticing? Right? What kind of questions do you have about what's going on? Let me check my trusty smartphone device and see if any of you 319s have blown up my phone yet. What's going on for you guys? Signals of the future. While you're texting in your questions, I want to share an anecdote with you. I've been doing this work for 25 years now. I started my business in the basement of my home in Des Moines 25 years ago. And it was the first place I ever owned a home. I bought my first home here. This state means a lot to me. But I remember being asked to come to a breakfast like this. It was like the annual event, but it was like the breakfast, right? So everybody's having coffee instead of wine, and all the lights were up, not down. And I was sitting at the table like I am here this evening, and I turned to the person on my left who was the chairperson of the organization whose annual meeting it was, and I said, so what's this community's vision of itself? And he said, you know, I don't know that we have one. And it was such an offhanded question, you know? I wasn't trying to stump him, I wasn't trying to trick him, but since that point, and as my business has developed over the years, what I've realized is that if we can take a moment and do some horizon thinking instead of just sidewalk thinking, right? If we can do some horizon thinking and think about where it is we really want to go, and we develop that clear vision, it's like Polaris. It's like that star the North Star in the sky, right? When you think about the North Star, That's not where we're going, right? Sailors didn't use the North Star because they were like, I'm headed there, right? It's a guidance system. And that's what a strong vision is. It's a guidance system. So my hat is really off to all of you who helped develop the All-In Vision Plan, because it is giving us a guidance system, right? You've got it right here. Five, no BS, we gotta get these things done by 2030 goals, and these are broad enough that all of us can find a way in. Okay, oh, here's a 920. Is somebody else from Scani up in here? Oh, hello, sir. Well, now I feel like I can't read your thing right now because the anonymity has just gone out the window. Okay, how do we gently challenge upper management who may be resistant to believe in the forward movement that's occurring in our city? Here's what I would say. You can't change upper management. I mean, it can't be done, especially if they don't want to be changed, right? But what you can do is you yourself lead by example, right? Get so excited and so involved that maybe they'll tag along. But your behavior should not be dependent on anyone else's behavior. And I don't know if the question is in here, but I gotta say one more thing about like the Johnson County, state of Iowa thing. Focus on what you can control, right? We spend so much time worried about what's happening in the governor's mansion or in the legislature, right? Focus on what you can control. Focus on what you can influence. Because at the end of the day, all the issues get solved, most of them, at the local level. Okay, I'm gonna take one more question and then I'm gonna be texting all of you back later. Okay. Last four digits, 8056. Our younger generations are going to demand more and more freedom, autonomy in their work, and they will be our promise for equity and inclusion. We need to get out of their way. Preach. How do we meet them where they are? There's a beautiful, I mean, now the science actually shows this as well, right? Young people need people who believe in them, and older people become the wisdom keepers in the community. We're the ones with the networks. We're the ones with the money, you know? We're the ones who can put our capital behind somebody, and it kind of comes back to that chair at the table. You know, when we talk about building an intersectional community or a multi-generational community, we're not asking our older residents to leave the table. We're saying, move over and pull a seat up for a member of the next generation. And you know, there's research that shows that communities that have strong intergenerational ties turn out more poet laureates, more Nobel laureates, more scholars. It's an amazing thing. So let's not fall into the one or the other trap. Like either we're for older workers or we're for younger workers. Let's be for everybody. Right, and let's just make the table a little bit bigger for everybody. Okay, before I go, you know what the perfect team size is? Like if you study startups and startups that turn into great companies, innovations that turn into things that really change communities, perfect size of a team is two. Two! So if you have like a crazy idea, all you need is one friend. And I really want to emphasize the word lab in collaboration. One of the great things that we talked about throughout the Better Together 2030 process was the idea that we need to start making friends with risk, right? And I'm not talking like gamble all the house money risk, but I'm saying like, let's try it risk, right? Oh, okay, a big clap there. So, when you think about these five pillars for All In Vision, and there's gonna be many opportunities for you to be involved, you know, moving forward, who's the one person you wanna bring to one of these things and try something with, right? Because, you know, you can start with a domino that is very, very small, and one domino can knock over the next domino that's 1.3 size, 1.3 of its size. So if I start with a 5-millimeter domino, after 29 dominoes, I can knock over the World Trade Center, right? Or the Empire State Building. It's amazing how we can start with these very small steps with one other person and just try something. Here are three examples of groups that are just trying something. Fingers crossed, you will build the first in the country two-story 3D printed house right here in this community. Collaboration. How many of you have been through CLP, the adult version? A lot of CLP alumni in the, yep, and everybody's alumni class was the best class, wasn't it? Yep, I know how y'all roll. So how about this group of folks who was like, this shouldn't just be for like the grown-ups, this should be for the kids. So they're starting a youth-centered CLP program, collaboration, right? And then finally, I can't wait to tell my community about this. You have figured out how to unplug the tub around childcare, right? How to do affordable childcare for parents, but that can also provide true living wages for caretakers. This is amazing. We're putting our hands together tonight because somebody was brave enough to hold up their hand and say, I'm gonna call a couple people, right? I'm gonna get with another person. Collaboration, power of two, try it, just try it. And with all due respect to this wonderful gal who introduced me, my challenge to you is to ask if you are all in. Thank you.
Can I shut that?
Sorry, we gotta find our page here.
I'm good. Right there.
That's Rebecca.
No, that's me.
Oh, yeah.
I'm good.
Oh, that's you. Okay.
All right. So, thank you, Rebecca. I know that I was. And I asked to play this part because I know that through this entire process that I was your hardest pupil. thank you. I have such appreciation for the work that you do and the leadership that you continue to provide all of us. You know, we're so fortunate to have your guidance as we've crafted this All In Vision plan. We now encourage each of you to scan the QR code on the back of your programs, and from there you can check out the bt2030.org website to get a deeper understanding of those five pillars, those 5-20-30 pillars that have been talked about. I know our particular organization is heavily involved in pillar number one with the Iowa River and the natural environment and trails. The link will also provide an opportunity to get involved in all transformational projects and work groups. You can learn more about the exciting projects already underway with 3D printing, the Iowa River Reclamation, which I referenced, and then the Child Care Wage Enhancement Program. And importantly, you will have an opportunity to donate to or support the work through the Community Foundation of Johnson County, which is our terrific partner headed up by Shelley. You each have unique strengths in this room, resources, and most importantly, connections. And we encourage you to spend some time with our team to identify how you can leverage this community-wide plan for our shared future. Thank you.
So while you're looking on the back of your programs, I want to acknowledge a few fellow supporters of Better Together 2030. Thank you to Johnson County, the City of Iowa City, City of Coralville, City of North Liberty, the University of Iowa, the Iowa City Community School District, United Way of Johnson and Washington Counties, the Community Foundation of Johnson County, the Iowa City Downtown District, and South of Six. Does take a village. Let's give them all a round of applause. We have all accomplished so much together already, and we hope that you consider adding your organization's name to this incredible list. I also want to give a special thanks to the Better Together 2030 Executive Director, Katie Gerlach. Katie just began work. Yes, where is Katie? Stand up, Katie. There she is. There she is. So Katie just began work to activate and track the All-In Vision Plan last August, and she's already accomplished so much in laying the groundwork and launching the plan into action, as you could see from Rebecca's presentation. We're so grateful to have her, and I think it was one of our best decisions that we made to bring her on board. So thank you, Katie.
And I get the opportunity to bookend this thing. So in closing, I just want to thank our lead sponsor again, Procter & Gamble. Thank you. With all our other sponsors and all of our other sponsors for making this evening possible. Thank you, President Wilson and Rebecca Ryan, for sharing with us tonight. And thank you all for coming, celebrating, and collaborating with us. We are proud to be working in partnership with all of you to create this outstanding community. Clap, 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 clap. So you're all invited to join us for a drink at Edgewater Grill, continue these conversations, and enjoy the rest of your evening. Thank you again, and we look forward to a 2023 and All-In 2030 vision. Thank you.